Hi all, welcome to Small Catalyst, 23rd February 2019. Today we will be discussing these six topics. The first article is related with the surveillance of Uyghur Muslims by the Chinese government. The second is related with the joint effort being undertaken to initiate 5G rollout in India. Third is related with India's proposal of having new domain name server for safe browsing. Fourth is related with an RBI action of bundling all NBFCs into a single category. The fifth one is related with the inclusion of Mudra loanees into employment sector. The last one is about the conclusion of Naga peace agreement. We are all aware of the fact that China is doing a social surveillance project. The social actions of the citizens of China are ranked and based on which their public facilities would be offered. In similar line, they are also implementing those surveillance programs over Uyghur Muslims. Uyghur Muslims belong to the Kashgar region along the northwestern part of China. Communist Chinese government sees the presence of minority Uyghur Muslims as an opponent to the presence of communist ideology. So they are in the process of re-educating the Uyghur Muslims. They are undertaking various campaigns thereby to convert the Uyghur Muslims or to make the Uyghur Muslims accede to the communist ideology of Chinese government. Okay, in order to achieve this re-education, the Chinese are using various methods of surveillance and oppression. Now the Chinese government is using the DNA analysis method to survey the Uyghur Muslims. The irony here is, in order to verify, in order to check the veracity of any DNA sample, we need a benchmark sample or we need a test sample. Here the irony is, the action of a communist government is being supported by a capitalist nation. Yes, USA is supporting China in order to assess the veracity of DNAs. This comprehensive DNA database being built by the Chinese government, it could be used to chase down any Uyghurs who resist the campaign. And these DNA databases collected are managed in United States. The sad part is that the initiative of Chinese government has got cooperation from the global scientific community, thereby legitimizing this type of genetic surveillance. The personal autonomy of Uyghur Muslims are violated in this case, and this violation of personal autonomy is also violating their liberty as a group of individuals. This violation of personal autonomy acts as a tool to violate the democratic rights enjoyed by the Uyghur Muslim. The second article is about the importance of joint effort in rollout of 5G technology in India. We have witnessed the evolution of mobile phone technology, mobile communication from 1G, 2G, 3G, 4G. And the next big thing is the 5G technology. The rollout of 5G technology has more positive implication on the development of big data, data analytics, and Internet of Things. In order to provide high speed wireless connectivity, the 5G connection would provide peak data transmission of 20 gigabytes per second. And it has technological development to automate many network behaviors, and it can also provide a platform enabling services for vertical markets. In order to have a smooth rollout of 5G technology in India, there has been a combined effort undertaken by industry players. Here the regulator is TROI. TROI had released a white paper on enabling 5G in India. So based on this, the regulator and the industry players are working to implement 5G rollout in India. The standards, any mobile communication network has standards being fixed by an international body. For the 5G technology, the standards are defined by third generation partnership project. This is a potential area of in prelims. The government of India is aiming to launch 5G in India by the end of 2020. And the 5G has enormous impact on economic development of the country, and it is expected that by the end of 2035, the amount of revenue generated through the 5G technology would be about $1 trillion. As we saw earlier, the different mobile phone generations, they were focused on providing consumer services. Here, this 5G is providing not only consumer services, it will also have positive impact on various industries. As I mentioned earlier, it has various applications in technology development areas. Also, it has impact in manufacturing areas. For example, it can be used for application-oriented robotics in automotive sector and augmented reality sectors. The National Policy on Electronics 2019 is focused at making India a digitally connected. In order to become a digitally connected nation, it is pertinent for India to invest on more new technologies like 5G, and it's a right step being taken by the Indian government. The third article is about the RBI decision of bundling various NBFCs into one type. into one type, thereby offering operational flexibility. Too much of anything would lead to chaos. In order to have hassle-free operational flexibility, it is necessary to have few number of groups. RBI has created a single category for non-banking lenders. This line, RBI has created a single category for various non-banking lenders. The asset finance companies, loan companies and investment companies, they have been merged into a new category called NBFC investment and credit companies. In the recent NBFC liquidity crisis, the exposure to NBFCs without any risk-weighted classification created flutters in the stocks of banks. And in order to avoid this, RBI has mandated that any exposure to NBFCs other than core investment companies will be risk-weighted as per credit ratings. As far as the core investment companies are concerned, the exposure will be fully risk-weighted. The difference here is exposure to NBFCs other than these core investment companies will be risk-weighted based on their credit ratings. This should be remembered. So harmonization of different categories into a fewer ones is based on the principle of regulation by activity rather than the regulation by entity. This effort undertaken by RBI to merge asset finance companies, loan companies and investment companies all involved in a similar function is based on the principle of regulation by activity rather than regulation by entity. The fourth article is about the provision of a domestic domain name server by the Indian government. The world has become more interconnected today, and the interconnected world has come at the cost of cyber crimes. India ranks fourth at the world in the countries with high cyber crimes, and there are also issues of privacy popping up. In order to avert all this, government has been introducing the localization of data localization norms. And one important step towards achieving this complete data localization to have own domain name server for India. This DNS is aimed at providing faster and more secure browsing experience for internet users in the country. Also, it ensures that the data of the users are stored within the boundaries of India. What is DNS? DNS acts as a directory of the internet, and it helps to convert the domain names which are used by we remember a website. The users remember website by names, whereas the computer remembers the websites by IP address and domain name server. This DNS acts as a medium between the user and the computer. It converts domain names, that is a website name, into the machine understandable IP addresses. In this way, it becomes more important in accessing internet. If the DNS is slow or it is failing to work, the users will not be able to locate web addresses in a more efficient manner. It will create hassles in the functioning of the internet. The rollout is expected to be over in next 4 to 6 months, and it would be undertaken by the National Informatics Center. Fifth article is about the recent report submitted by the Labor Bureau on jobs created by Mudra loans. The Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana was launched in the year 2015 in order to extend affordable credit to micro and small enterprises. The loan size varied from 50,000 to 10 lakhs. It had three classifications: Shishu, Kishore and Tarun. Under Shishu category, the loans were below 50,000, and in Kishore it ranged from 50,000 to 5 lakhs, and in Tarun it ranged between 5 lakhs to 10 lakh. These loans were provided to the beneficiaries belonging to small manufacturing units, service sector units, shopkeeper, fruit and vegetable vendors, truck operators, food service units and others. And it was expected that by providing loan to these beneficiaries, the employment generation in the market would be picking up. And the recent report of Labor Bureau is based on this belief that by providing loans to micro and small enterprises, the employment generation would be increasing in the economy. This Labor Bureau report has come in the backdrop of recent analysis of findings citing that the unemployment hit a 45-year high in the year of 2017-18. To doctor data, this move undertaken by the government to doctor data to support its claims on creating employment has been criticized by various labor economists. The last article is about the continuing process of finalizing an agreement between Naga groups and the central government. Nagas are the tribal people living along the northeastern part of India. A good number of Naga population is distributed along three Indian states and in Myanmar. The three Indian states are Nagaland, Manipur, and Mizoram. They are demanding for a separate Nagaland, a separate territory for the Naga people. The demand of Nagas for a separate territory is not a new one. It is a legacy issue, and it started from the year 1881 when the Naga Hills was annexed by the British colonizers. The collective consciousness of Naga arised after the formation of Naga Club in the year 1980. And during June 1947, a month before India's independence, a 9-point agreement was signed between prospective independent Indian government and the Naga groups. In 1952, there was a kind of skirmish between the central government and Nagaland and Naga groups, and this was brought into control by armed forces. After this, in the year 1962, a 16-point agreement was signed. As a continuing effort to the 16-point agreement, which led to the creation of Nagaland state, a ceasefire was signed between India and Naga rebels in 1964. This ceasefire was broken down in year 1972. We have witnessed this trend in many rebel groups against the central governments all over the world. First, they will sign a ceasefire, then in order to negotiate something, they would receive something from the government, the rebellion breaks up again, then they will sign a ceasefire, then they will go for the process of and by signing ceasefire, then they will get some advantageous position from the government again. This is a continuing process all over the world. The same applies here too. Ceasefire broke down in 1972, and in 1975, an accord was signed between Government of India and Naga Nationalist Council. Following the universal trend, after the signing of Shillong Accord, few NNC rebels formed NSCN, National Socialist Council of Nagaland, in 1980, and they broke up. One led by Kaplang and another led by Isaac Muwaya. The Kaplang faction of NSCN is more violent and they believe in armed conflict, whereas Isaac Muwaya is into dialogues. In 1997, the NSCN faction led by Isaac Muwaya signed a ceasefire with India. As a continuation of this, in 2015, a framework of peace agreement, it's not an actual peace agreement, a framework on how the peace agreement would be availed, was announced by Prime Minister Modi in presence of the NSCN leader Isaac Muwaya, and Mr. Ravi was made as interlocutor to undertake discussion between the government and the Naga group NSCN IM. Now it has come in the news because the continuing process along with the introduction of Citizenship Bill 2016 has created a gall-like situation in the undergoing dialogue process. And this roadblock indicates that the Naga peace agreement would not be completed before 2019 as expected during 2015. Thank you.